Welcome to our Crossing the Tiber series with converts from Southern Evangelical Seminary. Just a couple announcements about how the night's going to go tonight with three different conversion stories. So the first of them will come up, start with a prayer, give his conversion story, open it up for questions, followed by the second one, questions you might have for them, followed by the third, and then at the end, if you have kind of more general questions for all of them, they'll all come up and you can take questions that way as well, all right? So without further ado, I'm going to welcome up Scott Carney, who's going to be our first speaker. Oh.
Now, there's no place to put these things. Well, good evening. My name is Scott Carney. During this series, we've had a convert who's a former Methodist pastor, a convert who's a professional soccer player, converts who are now priests. So now they have rolled out the schmuck. I am a former nobody and a current nobody. So, like Tim said, Brian and Gretchen and I come from evangelical backgrounds, so let's begin with a most unevangelical act and ask for Our Lady's intercession. So in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So this series is called Crossing the Tiber. And for those of you who are unfamiliar, Rome is located on the eastern bank of the Tiber River. And so crossing the Tiber is the metaphor for those people who cross over from the Protestant evangelical world to the world of Roman Catholicism. And the metaphor also is appropriate because for some people, the swim across the river is very difficult and time-consuming. For me, it was pretty quick and easy, and the story is not dramatic or powerful, notwithstanding the announcement during Mass yesterday. I'm going to place my story, though, in a framework that hopefully will allow you to understand my conversion and that of others. And because of time, I'm going to need to skip over and kind of gloss over a lot of things. So I was raised in a suburb of Washington, D.C., and I have three older brothers and a younger sister. And my religious background growing up really was inconsequential, and it ended when my mom died of cancer when I was 12. And after that, I never went to church except for weddings and funerals until I was 24. And I don't have time to describe the process, but I became a Christian and was baptized in 1987, around the same time that I moved to Williamsburg to begin law school at the College of William and Mary. And at the same time, my sister was becoming Catholic during her last year of college. She had become a Christian a few years earlier. And for me, my life really was changed and different from then on, and I've always taken my faith seriously. I was healed of the emotional wound caused by my mom's death and, you know, found meaning and purpose in life that I had haphazardly sought in the years after her death. And I attended a non-denominational church in Williamsburg called Williamsburg New Testament Church, and began to grow in my faith. And because of my sister, I was never anti-Catholic. I was indifferent. I never explored Catholicism or thought that it could be true. Instead, I began digging deeper and deeper into the evangelical world. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, this is what that world looks like in part. So evangelicals believe that the Bible is God's only revelation of truth. It is inerrant, and all Christians should read the Bible regularly and obey its teachings. Little or no thought is given to where the Bible actually comes from historically. It's just always been there. And the gospel message is that everyone needs a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and needs to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. That's the big phrase that everyone needs to do. And this is a moment in time saving faith. What happens after that is a matter of discipleship. It's not a matter of salvation. Evangelicalism means that you go to your local church every week and attend a Sunday school class and maybe a midweek service. You're probably involved in a small group which meets regularly for fellowship, prayer, and support. You might also be part of another Bible study or other prayer group, and you're probably involved in some other ministry connected with your church, such as teaching Sunday school or volunteering for the nursery, helping with vacation Bible school, you know, attending a men's prayer breakfast or missions, you know, prayer group or support group. There is a list of institutions, colleges, seminaries, parachurch organizations, authors, theologians, musicians with which all evangelicals are familiar. And evangelicals know a lot of traditional hymns to sing in church, and they also know the modern praise and worship songs. And evangelicals will shop for a church until they find one which best fits their needs, interests, and tastes. You know, so basically, the music is pretty good, the preaching is pretty good, I have some friends here, it's a good community. It fits my needs and my family's needs. Evangelicals are against the alleged authority of tradition, and they are also suspicious of any Christian leader or institution which claims to have authority. So Christ is an authority. The Bible has authority. The rest of us, we're simply followers. Every Christian is a saint. Nobody is special, not even clergy. Church authority and saints and priests, evangelicals, semi-consciously associate with the Dark Ages, a time of religious oppression and human misery. So those are some of the defining marks of evangelicalism. There are many, many more that I could unpack, but I don't have time. And so by 1995, 1996, I was deeply entrenched in this world. I was involved in various ministries and had grown and matured in my faith. And my passion really was in ministry and the things of God, not my job. And so I began thinking about seminary, and others told me that they sensed the call for me to go into ministry. And I only considered two seminaries and settled on Southern Evangelical Seminary here in Charlotte. And Southern Evangelical Seminary, or SES, was co-founded in 1992 by Ross Rhodes and Norman Geisler. Rhodes was an evangelist and was then pastor of Calvary Church, the big pink church off Pineville Matthews Road in South Charlotte. And Geisler was a longtime seminary professor and popular Christian apologist. And in a nutshell, apologetics is the task of developing and sharing arguments for the objective truth and rationality of Christianity. You know, so St. Thomas Aquinas's five proofs for the existence of God, that's a form of apologetics. And so most people at that time, including me, came to SES to study apologetics and philosophy under Dr. Geisler. The seminary's dispensationalist theology really wasn't a factor, at least it wasn't for me. And SES is committed to classical apologetics and medieval philosophy, specifically that of St. Thomas Aquinas. It's kind of interesting. So the works of Aquinas are assigned as readings more frequently than Augustine, Martin Luther, John Calvin, or any number of modern evangelical writers. In the seminary, we try to bifurcate Aquinas's philosophy from his theology and say, well, his philosophy was right, but his theology is not. Or they would reinterpret him and say, he basically was a Protestant just before the Protestant Reformation happened. Okay? And so Aquinas is really the seminary's unofficial patron saint. And there were unintended consequences to that, which I'll let Gretchen share. I know it's part of her story. I'm not sure if it's part of Brian's or not. I'll shortly find out. I think it is. And so while in seminary, I worked full-time, and I took one or two classes per semester. And so it took me 11 years to finish. And I was graduated in 2007 with a Master of Divinity with an emphasis in apologetics. And around this same time, the Holy Spirit began drawing dozens and dozens and dozens of SES students and two professors to the Catholic faith, including Brian and Gretchen. I was not part of that movement. In fact, I didn't even know it had happened or was going on until years later during my own conversion period. And so there are numerous Catholic conversion books, such as Rome Sweet Home by Scott and Kimberly Hahn. My favorite conversion book is How to Go from Being a Committed Evangelical, or How to Go from Being a Good Evangelical to a Committed Catholic in 95 Difficult Steps by Christian Smith. And Smith points out that the move from being an evangelical to a Catholic is not the same as a Baptist becoming a Methodist or a Presbyterian or one of the more traditional Protestant denominations. Becoming a Catholic is more like a scientific paradigm shift. Okay, so scientific theories change in a series of violent revolutions that overturn entire worldviews just all at once. And they're preceded by, there'll be a normal scientific paradigm relies on broad assumptions about the world. And then over time, scientists discover new data or anomalies that contradict that dominant paradigm. And so if these anomalies start accumulating over more and more or in intensity, they can cause a crisis for the current paradigm, and scientists begin looking for a new paradigm, a new alternative paradigm that has the elements of the current paradigm, but then can also deal with its anomalies. And when this new paradigm is discovered, the only consistent reaction is to adopt it. And so my paradigm was the evangelical culture, some of which that I described earlier. And over time, I accumulated certain anomalies that did not fit that established evangelical paradigm. And so here are the main one using Smith's categories. The first one is begin to feel rootless. And so generally, the evangelical world felt like a comfortable and secure place for me. But I increasingly found myself feeling that the evangelical world was very shallow. Okay, the first church of which I was a part, Williamsburg New Testament Church, was founded in 1975. I never identified myself as a dispensationalist because one problem that I had with it was that it's such a recent development. It was developed in the mid-1800s. And I thought, in the charismatic movement of which I was a part, has a strong emphasis on the work of the Holy Spirit in the believer and in the church. And I thought to myself, if dispensationalism is true, why did it take the Holy Spirit over 1,800 years to unveil this truth to the church? Okay, why did it take the Holy Spirit nearly 2,000 years to enlighten the founders of Williamsburg New Testament Church and other like-minded churches to recapture the essence of the early church. You know, it seems like the Holy Spirit is pretty poor at his job, if all that is true. You know, but Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would guide the apostles in the church into all truth, but it appears that the Holy Spirit has allowed the church to wallow in error for thousands of years, and then just recently has led the church into all truth. Didn't really make sense. So a second anomaly was start to notice church fragmentation and disunity. You know, evangelicals believe that God knows who his faithful are, and whoever they are is who make up the invisible church, the true church. And so all of the saints in all places and times, that's what the church is, not the visible church. But it always bothered me, though, how thoroughly and deeply the visible Christian church is divided. And there are scores of Bible passages calling for Christian unity and harmony and condemning church division and schism, including in John chapter 17, where Jesus says, may they be one so that the world would know that you sent me. You know, how can the world see unity in an invisible church? Again, doesn't make sense. And so given their common beliefs about the inerrancy and sufficiency of Scripture, you would think that the evangelical culture I described is a monolithic, unified view, but it is not. You know, evangelicals endlessly argue over theological issues, and I hated theological arguments because they never went anywhere, and they tended to generate more heat than light. Basically, whoever argued the loudest and the longest was the one who won. So a third anomaly, and related to this one, is notice the Bible's inability to settle matters in dispute. And so the biggest defining mark of Protestantism, evangelicalism, is sola scriptura, that the Bible alone is the divinely inspired and infallible authority for the faith and practice. And implicit in sola scriptura is the idea of the perspicuity of Scripture, that the Bible is clear in its teaching so that even ordinary people can understand it well. All right, here's the problem. Every other evangelical believes the same thing about the Bible, but end up claiming that the Bible teaches very different and sometimes incompatible things on a number of topics. And this is well illustrated by the Counterpoint series of books published by an evangelical publisher, and there are 38 volumes currently in the series. I'm sure there's more coming. And here are some of its titles: 5 Views on Sanctification, 4 Views on Divine Providence, 4 Views on Eternal Security, 4 Views on Hell, Understanding 4 Views on Baptism, Understanding 4 Views on the Lord's Supper, Who Runs the Church, 4 Views on Church Government. Okay, that's only a handful of the 38 volumes. So if the Bible is clear and authoritative, then why do we have all these disagreements? You know, something must be wrong. And so what I concluded is the Bible alone is not able to settle matters of dispute, because if it were, all disputes would be settled by now. It's been 2,000 years, all right? They should be all settled, but they're not. They just continue to rage on. Something is wrong. So I had been living in this evangelical paradigm for close to 30 years, but had also accumulated these and really a number of other anomalies. And I was also troubled by the lack of holiness in the evangelical world, including in me. You know, nobody ever seemed to change. You know, in the world, and believers looked more like the world than Jesus. And the explanation was always, well, that's just the way I am, you know, and God loves me the way I am. And so in early 2016, I purchased this book. It's called The Ancient Path by John Michael Talbot. And he is a popular Catholic musician. And my sister gave me one of his CDs shortly after I became a Christian. And I've always enjoyed his music and have read some of his books over the years and have learned from them and just kind of navigated through the Catholic flavor of them. But this book is about the early church fathers and was my first introduction to certain things like the Didache, which is a manual of church order written around the same time as the New Testament. And Talbot writes that the Didache presents salvation not as a matter of a moment, but as a way of life. It is a life lived in the church, a life born from the baptismal waters and fed at the Lord's table. The church sustains God's children and strengthens them for life on earth, which, make no mistake, is a trial. And so another quote that's an antidote to the anomalies I had accumulated. He writes, "What then did the fathers do? They set the limits of the Christian biblical canon. They crafted the classic creeds. They laid down the methods of scriptural interpretation. And they established the church's moral discipline and sacramental rites." And then in describing his own experience with the evangelical world in the early 1970s, Talbot writes, "Now my experience of sin was tangled up in the scandal of confusion of Christianity itself. The conflicting interpretation of Scripture and the sometimes fierce and mutually destructive divisions perpetuated by believers. As much as I needed salvation from my old sins, I also needed to be saved from the mess of contemporary Christianity. The church, in fact, was the ordinary means of salvation established by Jesus, and it applied salvation by means of the sacramental mysteries also established by Jesus." And then finally he writes, "Scripture was written and compiled by the church, so it is rightly interpreted in the context of the church from which and through which it came. To isolate Scripture from its source is to cut it off from the living stream of the Spirit." And so all of this was just kind of hitting me like thunderbolts. And halfway through reading this book, the thought entered my mind, I want to be Catholic. And that thought was not objectionable. And in hindsight, it really was a grace. It was a gift of faith that I recognized Catholicism to be true. I could see that the divisions, the endless theological arguments, the lack of holiness, and the church shopping in evangelicalism was because we have been severed from our roots. Okay, I felt rootless because I was rootless. And so I began replacing my evangelical paradigm with a Catholic one. And I began attending Mass here in the spring of 2016. I began RCIA in 2017. And before that, I started reading conversion stories and reading books about Catholic doctrine. So again, I started RCIA in 2017. And entered into full communion with the Catholic Church at the 2018 Easter Vigil. So it was nearly 5 years ago. And I have completely abandoned the Protestant evangelical paradigm. It now seems like an alien and bizarre world. Okay, I was in that world for so long that it probably affects me in ways that I'm not aware. And I help Gretchen with RCIA now, and I'm one of the catechists, and I tell her that I don't like to wing things because I'm afraid that I will serve, I'll unintentionally teach really evangelical doctrine, you know, that I'll serve an evangelical piece of meat with some Catholic seasoning in it rather than serve Catholic meat. So for those of you who are lifelong Catholics, I'll end with this metaphor, which I've used before. I have a niece who never had a donut until she was about 6 years old. And the first time she ate a donut, her reaction was, "Wow, these bagels are really good." And so converts like me and Gretchen and Brian can come across as explaining how delicious donuts are to people who've been eating donuts their entire lives. Okay, but hopefully hearing their stories will remind you that donuts, your Catholic faith is delicious. And in this metaphor, donuts not only are delicious, they are more nutritious than bagels as well. So any questions?
The one that I read, it's called The Ancient Path.
It was the right time. It wasn't dramatic in the same way that, like, you know, Scott Hahn, if you read his book, you know, that was like it took him years to really wrestle through all the issues. I've always been kind of a gut instinct person when it comes to spiritual things for some reason. And fortunately, God has not led me astray so far, at least that I'm aware. So, Jerry? You know, Jerry, for me, there really wasn't. I know people struggle with different issues. For me, it really boils down to the authority of the church. And once you're settled on that, then all of the issues just kind of fell into place. Like, I didn't struggle with the Mary issue. I didn't struggle with this and this and this. Because for whatever reason, you know, given my background, I was ready. I didn't want five views on things. Okay, I wanted somebody to tell me what was true. All right, I'm a pretty bright person in some respects. You know, I was in school for 30 years. But, you know, since it took me 11 years to finish seminary, you know, it was 12 years through college. I mean, 12 years through high school, 4 years of college, 3 years of law school, 11 years of seminary. But I'm not that smart. Okay, you know, I can't figure out how to set the DVD on my, I can't figure out how to set the time on my alarm clock, on my clock radio without looking at the manual, all right? I don't have any illusions that I'm bright enough to figure out the mysteries of God on my own. But that's really your option. Either you got to place your faith and your authority in something, and it's either yourself or it's the Catholic Church. And once I made that leap, and that was a pretty easy leap for me, all of the issues and doctrines and whatnot, it just all falls into place for me. Not everybody is like that. You know, I don't even really remember. I bought another book. I've always been interested in, I've always been, or for the last 10 years before I became a Catholic, I was always interested in ancient things, not necessarily Catholic things, but I knew that, unlike a lot of Protestants, I knew that Christianity didn't begin with the Protestant Reformation, you know, or even with the, you know, I came from a charismatic background. It didn't end with the charismatic movement in the early 1960s or the early 1900s or whenever. So I was always attuned to, you know, the historical nature of our faith and was drawn to that. And so at the same time I bought this book, I bought another book that he wrote, you know, that was about the saints. But for some reason I started reading this book first, and I don't know. I really don't remember why I bought it. But I'm glad I did. Yes. I'm sorry. You know, after I became a Catholic, I asked my sister, "Have you been praying for me this whole time?" And she's like, "No." And I'm like, "Oh, love you too." You know, she told me she always thought I would be happier if I became Catholic, which I still need to ask her about that, because I never really was an unhappy person or whatever. The two of us never tried to convert each other. Like, I never tried to convert her to even out of Catholicism, because I recognized that God had done something in her life. I think she recognized the same thing in me, so we just kind of, I don't want to say tolerated each other. We just accepted each other in whatever face that we had. So she was very happy, of course, and pleased when I decided to convert. You know, I'm still trying to figure out how the charismatic flavor of my past fits into Catholicism. I know that there is a major kind of charismatic Catholic vein. I haven't really explored it on my own, though. I'm kind of still settling in on learning doctrine and all that kind of good stuff. All right, I think my 5 minutes of questions is up, so I'm going to turn it over to Brian.
It's great to be with you. I got my stopwatch going here, so otherwise, who knows how long we'll be up here rambling, right? Scott, that was fantastic. Thank you so much for doing a lot of the legwork and explaining certain aspects of evangelical Christianity. I am, however, disappointed. He said his favorite conversion book, I thought he was about to say Evangelical Exodus, but didn't quite go there. What's that? That's your second. Okay, there we go. You're redeemed. So Evangelical Exodus, so this is a talk given by three SES converts, or Southern Evangelical Seminary converts. This is a book that a group of converts wrote who have graduated from the seminary. And so you have, of course, all different conversion books out there. Uniquely, this one is from a group of students that graduated from the same Protestant seminary and eventually became Catholic, so... it's a fantastic book, if you have never heard of it. Anyways, it is wonderful to be here with you guys. This is my first time to try to give my testimony to a certain extent with adults. So I'm a high school theology teacher. I'm in my 10th year of teaching at Charlotte Catholic High School. So I'm very comfortable speaking to teenagers, and so it's been a while since I've spoken with adults about this sort of a topic. So it's great to be with you. A little bit about myself. I'm married. We have been blessed with 9 children. Very, very blessed. We're from the great state of Texas. We moved out here in 2005. My family and I came into full communion with the church 10 years ago, right here at St. Thomas Aquinas. And so it was on a Saturday morning. Tim was here. December of 2012 was the Feast of the Holy Family. Lots of sacraments were given on that Saturday morning, so it's really special just to be here and to be with you guys. Well, after multiple years of searching, studying, praying, asking lots and lots of questions, interacting with various Catholic laypersons as well as Catholic priests, by God's grace, my family and I came into full communion with the Catholic Church. Back then here in 2012, I was a bit spoiled in my Catholic experience here. So Father Winslow was the head pastor, and then Father Kalth was here as well. And then soon thereafter, we had Father Christian. So incredibly blessed to become Catholic here in the Diocese of Charlotte. Some really awesome, beautiful things happening in this diocese. A bit of my family background. So it was hard to decipher, okay, how should I put this together? So in 20 minutes, trying to give a sort of conversion story can be quite challenging. And of course, I had to leave out numerous things when it comes to my conversion, but I thought I would start with my family background. So my family background was steeped in evangelical Protestant Christianity. My dad is an ordained Baptist minister. His mother, my grandmother, taught Sunday school for a number of years at the local Baptist church, Royal Haven Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas. My dad's brother, Uncle Ken is how he's known to me, but he's Dr. Kenneth Matthews, is a seminary professor at Beeson Divinity School. So he's a respected biblical scholar. He's written multiple books in that vein. And so on my dad's side, very steeped in evangelical Protestant Christianity. Same thing on my mom's side. So my mom grew up Methodist. Her parents were excellent musicians. They were heavily involved in the Southern gospel music industry. So some of you might know who Johnny Cash is. He actually did a Southern gospel album, believe it or not. Two of the songs on his album were songs that were actually written by my grandfather. So on my dad's side and my mom's side, steeped heavily in evangelical Protestant Christianity. My parents have worked together in music ministry for over 40 years. When it comes to my upbringing, I was exposed to various traditions. So I was baptized in a Southern Baptist church. For a period of years, my parents worked in a Methodist church. At one point, they were an Assembly of God church, so I got a taste of the charismatic sort of movement in that sort of a setting. They've also worked in a Presbyterian setting. So I was exposed to quite a bit, various traditions in my background. Now, even though I was exposed to these various traditions, I was trying to think, okay, what were some common themes that I grew up with? When it came to my evangelical Christian background, what were some things that I could say about that? Number one, and Scott touched upon this in his talk, one of the big things in my evangelical Christian upbringing was the importance of having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. This was front and center. So it wasn't just, of course, having a head knowledge of our Lord. It was being in a relationship with him. This was supposed to be the center of one's life. And so I was taught that from a very young age. And looking back on my upbringing, I was very drawn to Jesus Christ from a young age. I remember when I was really little, maybe around 6 or 7 years old, I would read a children's Bible at nighttime before I would go to bed. I distinctly remember when my dad baptized me at Sagemont Baptist Church in Houston, Texas. And Baptist baptized by immersion, so it was a huge baptismal tank. So whole body goes under the water and comes back up. But that was a special moment, having my dad baptize me. I remember going to his room the night before, and he was coaching me on, okay, how should I hold my hand? What's he going to do? What do I do when he dunks me? You know, that sort of thing. But looking back, really being focused on having a personal relationship with Jesus, that was something that was fostered in my life. So growing up, I was involved in youth group activities. I participated in music ministry. My life heavily revolved around participating in the evangelical church that we happened to be a part of at the time. All right, so that's number one. Number two, another thing that was really passed on to me was the gift of music. Both of my parents were excellent musicians. They both majored in music in college. Dad got his master's degree. He almost got a doctorate. But I learned all different genres growing up. But one thing that really sticks out to me, and this actually became a significant help to me becoming a Catholic, was learning sacred music. And so even though I was exposed to different genres, sacred music was something that my parents really passed on to me. I remember in college, one of the favorite things that I sang. So my parents were excellent musicians. They passed that on to me. And so one of the things that I do is I sing at St. Anne. But of course, I used to sing here at St. Thomas Aquinas back in the day when we first became Catholic. But I remember in college, one of my favorite things that we sang as a choir at Baylor University, the largest Southern Baptist college in the country, was the Ave Maria by Franz Biebel. And looking back on that, I don't really think I realized what I was singing about. I really don't. And it wasn't until years later, after I had become Catholic and become exposed to the rich tradition of sacred music in Catholicism, I realized, wow, my favorite song was a song about the Blessed Mother, okay? So they pass along music to me. And just on a side note, when I was reading about the Mass, the Eucharist, the supernatural mysteries that were coming about when Mass was celebrated, one of the things that helped me convert, because I attended Mass for over 2 years before I actually took the step of faith and came into full communion with the church, but one of the things that really aided me in my conversion was the sacred music that was being sung at Mass. So what I was reading about, right, looking through the tradition, looking through church history, becoming exposed to Catholic apologetics, the sacred music that I was hearing in the Mass during the liturgy really helped to bring to life those supernatural mysteries. And so it's interesting, my parents really passed along to me the gift of music, and I can see looking back how God used that in a certain way to help me come into the fullness of the faith in the Catholic Church. This also reminds me of Tom Savoy. So when we first became a Catholic back in 2012, he was the music minister here. He had just started, and he really brought me along. I started singing with him here and learning from him. Of course, an incredible musician that he was, but also he was a fantastic friend. And so the friendship that I got to enjoy with him, you just, once again, you see how God used music when it comes to my journey to the Catholic faith. All right, so we got number one, emphasis on a personal relationship with Christ. Two, the gift of music. Three, another thing that my parents passed along to me, and I would say my upbringing as an evangelical Christian, was a very high view of sacred scripture. Very high view of sacred scripture, which is a beautiful gift. So we believed, as Scott articulated, that the Bible was utterly unique. And this ties to that Protestant foundational belief known as sola scriptura, right? The notion that scripture alone is the only infallible source of authority, right? It's in scripture alone that I find divine revelation. And so they passed on to me this very high view of sacred scripture. And I think I might have mentioned this before. My grandmother taught Bible study best, basically, for a number of years. I already mentioned my uncle to you. So one of the important questions that we would ask, so when we're studying theological topics, investigating theological issues, was, what does the Bible teach? What does the Bible say? Okay, more on that here in just a little bit. Lastly, the last thing that I thought of as far as my upbringing in evangelical Christianity was, that was passed on to me, especially from my family too, was having a healthy theological curiosity. A healthy theological curiosity. So I was really encouraged in my upbringing to investigate theological topics, to really ask questions, and to search out those questions and hopefully find answers to those questions. And like I said before, of course, the Bible was supposed to be a big part of providing the answers. So growing up, but especially too into my adult years, while I was attending seminary here in Charlotte, my parents and I, especially my dad and I, we would get into all sorts of conversations about theological issues. And I have some fond memories in doing that, just conversing on various theological topics. For example, some of you might be familiar with Calvinism versus Arminianism. Without going into too much detail and getting lost in the weeds, right, as Scott was articulating, you have various viewpoints on issues pertaining to salvation. Things like predestination, election, what does it mean to have faith? What do I have to believe in? You have these various thoughts out there in the world of Protestantism. And so I remember, for example, Calvinism. One of the aspects of Calvinism is once you believe in Jesus for your salvation, and this goes back to the sola fide part of Protestantism, right? I'm saved by grace through faith alone. Works are not supposed to be a part of the process. Okay, that's a hallmark of Protestantism going back 400 years. But once a person has placed their faith in Jesus, their eternal destiny is set. Right, a Calvinist would believe this, right? I believed in Jesus. All right, if I were to die right now, I know I'm going to heaven, okay? And then on the other hand, Arminianism is the notion that, no, okay, you believe in Jesus, you might not always believe in Jesus, you could reject him later on in your life, and this would mean you have lost your salvation. Now, even within those two camps, you have different views within those two camps, right? So it's not just, here's the Calvinist view, here's the Arminian view, right? So I remember growing up having all sorts of theological conversations in my family. And I was encouraged to really pursue answers to those questions. And so maybe you can kind of see where this is going. Ultimately, looking back, this is one of the big things that led me to seminary. So after I graduated from Baylor University, so I graduated with a degree in business finance, believe it or not, I worked in the business world for a short time, and I realized pretty quickly, okay, I'm not really interested in this. What do I want to do with my life? And so I had this, I was young at the time, somewhat naive notion, but my desire was, I really want to do something for God. I want to serve him. I don't really quite know what that looks like, but I want to serve him with my life. So I stopped working in the business world, and I eventually applied for a minister of music position at a small evangelical church in the Dallas area. Now, this was a bit nerve-wracking for me because although I had participated a lot in music and grown as a musician growing up, I had never been a leader. So applying for the job was a bit nerve-wracking for me. Lo and behold, of course, I ended up getting the job. So I started working in church life in the evangelical world. I forged a relationship with the head pastor there. His name is Steve Kerr. Eventually, he, along with another mentor, really encouraged me to go to Dallas Theological Seminary. So my first seminary experience was actually in Dallas, Texas, at Dallas Theological Seminary. Another thing that's part of the story is my father-in-law. My father-in-law was actually attending Dallas Theological Seminary. And so when I was going there, we were going there at the same time, and like with my family, we would have all sorts of interesting theological conversations and discussions. And so this topic of Calvinism came up, and he introduced me to Dr. Norman Geisler, who wrote a book called Chosen But Free, all on this particular topic. And so this is how I first got exposed to Dr. Norman Geisler. So while I was getting acquainted with Dr. Geisler, the theologian, who was the co-founder of Southern Evangelical Seminary, right, SES, I also became aware of apologetics and aware of him as this great evangelical Christian apologist. And so one thing leads to another, and my family and I, which at the time I was married with two children, we packed our things and we moved to Charlotte, North Carolina, so that I could study at Southern Evangelical Seminary with Dr. Norman Geisler. And those are some of the fondest memories that I have, being able just to read and study and, in a sense, debate, discuss, ask questions, search for answers. I learned a great deal from Southern Evangelical Seminary. So studying apologetics, philosophy, theology, studying the Bible, these were wonderful things that I was exposed to in my studies here at SES. But also, as was mentioned by Scott, I also became familiar with the angelic doctor, St. Thomas Aquinas. So he was a significant part of my evangelical Protestant education. It's kind of funny looking back. So Dr. Geisler would describe himself as an evangelical Thomist, which you and I might laugh at that sort of thing, right? Because when we think of St. Thomas Aquinas, of course, we're thinking of, hey, this is one of the greatest Catholic theologians in the history of the church. Right? We're not thinking, oh, this was an evangelical Protestant philosopher or theologian. So why did I ultimately go to seminary? I realized that one of the biggest reasons that I went to SES is because I wanted more of a solid intellectual foundational grounding for my Christian faith. In other words, I wanted to know what I believed about Christianity and why I believed it. And in knowing it, having that opportunity to actually live it out, right? Apply it to my life. Of course, the ultimate reason that a person should be a Christian is because simply, it's true, right? Going to SES in some very significant ways really did help to solidify my Christian faith and really began to show me that the Christian faith has very solid, it has a very solid rational foundation. So I'm very thankful for the education that I got there. All right, well, fast forward. I ended up doing 2 master's degrees. Thankfully, my wife is a superhero and was very supportive of me doing the Moses track like Scott, you know, taking about 6 or 7 years to graduate ultimately. But I ended up doing 2 master's degrees. The first one was in apologetics. The second one was in biblical studies. And it was during this time when I really started to personally experience a crisis of faith. It was during my second master's degree that I was finally confronted with the Catholic question, is Catholicism true? So I did not grow up an anti-Catholic. That was not part of my upbringing. It just wasn't on the radar for me. It wasn't on the radar. I guess maybe I would think, oh, Catholicism, okay. Maybe they're Christians. They do some weird things. But I was never like anti-Catholic. You know, I was not of the mindset of, oh, well, if you're a Catholic, you are automatically going to hell, right? That was not my upbringing. So then what is it? What is it that led to me being confronted with the Catholic question? Well, one of the things involved Dr. Francis Beckwith. So if you don't know who that is, he was the president of the Evangelical Theological Society, which is this academic society for evangelical theologians. He was the president of this academic body. While he was the president, he converted to Catholicism. Yep. And later I found out it was a reversion. So evidently he grew up Catholic, and then he went away from his roots, and he became an evangelical Protestant. And then while he was the president of this society, he became a Catholic. Okay, what's going on here? Why in the world would he convert to Catholicism? He actually was a visiting professor at SES as well. Okay, what else did I become aware of? SES converts. I started to become familiar with, wow, you've got all these students that were being trained in exactly the same way that I was, receiving the same sort of theological, philosophical, apologetic education, and they were becoming Catholic. Okay, why? What's going on here, right? And then it was during my second master's degree, and what I was doing while I was going through school, I was teaching piano lessons privately. So I would go to school at night, I would teach piano lessons in the afternoon as well as the evenings. And one of the families that I taught was the Berettas. I don't know if anybody here knows the Berettas. So Fred Beretta, if you know Fred, he was actually on the plane that crashed in the Hudson. He was on that plane, believe it or not. But if you know Fred Beretta, he's the kind of Catholic, the kind of guy that really enjoys theological conversation. And he's an individual, right, that's striving to really be holy, really live this out. So when he became aware that I was attending seminary and I was teaching his kids piano, he, of course, wanted to talk some theology with me. So I remember him bringing up something pertaining to sola fide. I mean, do you think it's just faith alone, or do you think that works are part of the equation, right? So he was the kind of individual that he could really hold his own. You know, he could have a good conversation. And he's the one that first introduced me to Scott Hahn. Had no idea who Scott Hahn was, but he said, you know, you need to read about Scott Hahn's story and his conversion. And so later I became familiar with his conversion. But so he introduced me to Scott Hahn. So I had multiple things happening that was bringing the Catholic question to the surface here. It was bringing it on the radar, basically. Now, what really brought on the crisis, though, was all of this combined with something else. One of the reasons, looking back, okay, why did I go to seminary? One of those big reasons was so that I could gain clarity on various theological issues. Okay, I had a love for Jesus Christ, right? Yeah, I want to have a personal relationship with him. Okay, but what exactly does that mean? What does that entail? All right, what about this issue? What about that issue, right? I went to seminary ultimately because I wanted to gain clarity on these sorts of things, which were very important things, right? It's one thing to say you should have a personal relationship with Jesus. It's another thing to really explain what that means and what that entails. So during my second master's degree, I had already received a significant amount of education, right? Philosophy, theology, apologetics. And by this time, I was getting exposed to the biblical languages because we were taught that was one of the keys to being able to understand Scripture. You got to learn the Greek and the Hebrew so that you can study the New Testament in the original languages or the Old Testament in the original languages. Well, after all of the education that I received, I took a class on the book of Romans. It was an independent study. It was with Dr. Barry Leventhal, who just recently passed away. May he rest in peace. But one of his assignments for me was, okay, Paul wrote the book of Romans. Of course, we would not have called him St. Paul at the time, I would say. But he said, okay, what I want you to do is write a paper, and you're going to outline Paul's main argument. And if you know anything about the book of Romans, you'll know that one of the topics that is front and center in that book is the topic of salvation. How is a person saved, right? What is entailed in that? Well, it was at this time when I really started to experience the personal crisis, I started to realize all the education that I had received did not ultimately bring me clarity on what the truth was pertaining to that issue. And that's an issue that's not secondary, right? That's one of the most important issues, if not the most important issue. So I realized, wow, you have all of these Protestant biblical scholars. They've got similar educations, right? From what I can tell, they're striving to love God, to understand the truth taught in sacred scripture. Brilliant individuals, right? There's not a lack of IQ here. And when you read what they say about what Paul is teaching, they come to, surprise, surprise, different conclusions. Very different conclusions. And then it was at this time when I got exposed to the Catholic view. Okay, what do Catholics believe about this? And so I watched a debate between a Catholic apologist and a Protestant apologist on this topic of salvation, and I was incredibly surprised. The Catholic apologist wasn't even using tradition, wasn't even using church history, wasn't quoting any sort of magisterial teaching. He was just making the case from the Bible for the Catholic view of salvation. And he was making a pretty convincing case, I would say. I mean, not only did he hold his own in the debate, but I think that he actually might have won the debate. And of course, oral debates can be somewhat tricky, right? You could have somebody win a debate that's not necessarily in the truth because they have superior debating skills. But the lines of reasoning they was using, it was just, wow, what in the world? Now all of a sudden, it was right front and center. Is Catholicism true? And so that led me on a years-long process of study. And I became exposed to many of the various Catholic apologetic sort of arguments in support of the Catholic faith. It was interesting. I brought my doubts up to my wife. And this was towards the end of the second master's degree. And of course, she's been very patient with me, ready for me to graduate so that I can finally get a job and make progress in that regard for our family. And so here I am, after all of this education, bringing up doubts. You know what? How do I know which books are really supposed to be included in the Bible? Why is it 66 verses 73? All right, what about this problem of competing interpretations? How do I know which interpretation is the right interpretation? So I start bringing up the doubts, and of course, she was not a happy camper at first. But if you know my wife, she's very resilient. Believe it or not, she got to the point to where she was ready to become a Catholic before I was. So this led her on a study as well. So my wife and I have a great relationship. We would talk theology and apologetics, and so this led her into, okay, what's going on here? I need to study this as well. So what ended up happening? The Catholic paradigm really provided that clarity for me. Okay, this is one of the reasons why I became a Catholic. So when it comes to understanding, okay, who is God? What is his plan for us? It was never intended to be just me and my Bible and Jesus and my best guess. Okay, So I became exposed to the arguments for Christ really establishing the Catholic Church, investing his authority within that authority, providing divine safeguards to that authority. I saw the scriptural cases for that, and then, of course, I started to really look in church history for the first time. Church history was kind of more of an afterthought for me at Southern Evangelical Seminary, maybe not for some others. But I started to really investigate Christianity from a church history sort of perspective. And I found out, wow, this makes sense. Not only does it make sense, it really looks like Christ established the Catholic Church. And so this led me to light bulb moment after light bulb moment after light bulb moment. And ultimately what I discovered was these beautiful gifts that I was given as a Protestant, as an evangelical Protestant, really pointed me in the direction of the Catholic faith, which is where I found the fullness of the faith. And I found that clarity. And what does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? You learn about the importance of the sacramental life, the grace that we need so that we can be healed from the effects of sin and strengthened to live out those theological virtues. And so, to make a long story short, those desires that I had as an evangelical Christian really, in a sense, found fulfillment in the Catholic faith. We'll stop right there. Questions? I went way too long. You guys should have stopped me. Leave it to a high school teacher to... Right, Trish? Yeah. Yep. Absolutely. Big time. Big time. In fact, it was at one point my dad said to me, don't become Catholic. Don't do that. And there's this, what is it, anything but Catholic sort of saying, like, okay, you could have become a Presbyterian or an Anglican, but just don't become Catholic. I would say that sort of mindset was definitely in play. So it was difficult. There was definite tension, not only on my side of the family, but my wife's side of the family. My wife's parents will not attend a Mass. They won't do it. But my parents, on the other hand, sometimes they'll actually come to a Mass. So even though it was tough, they were still a bit more ecumenical than my wife's side of the family. And they even appreciated, like they saw, I think they knew, right, from experiencing it themselves and then from the conversations, they saw that there was at least some truth, goodness, and beauty in the Catholic faith. So it was one of those things for them. It was ultimately like, okay, I think you're making the wrong decision. This is not what you're really looking for. But, you know, they didn't think I was going to hell if I became a Catholic. So I didn't have to deal with that, which some people do have to deal with. Mr. Hebert. Yeah, it was a bit of a scary thing. Yeah, it's funny, I was ordained a Baptist minister in 2009, and I ended up attending my first Mass in the fall of 2010. And then I graduated with my second degree, master's degree, in the May of 2011. So it was one of those things where, yeah, I was not sure what was going to happen. So that was scary. Once again, my wife is a superhero, very patient, very understanding, but then also, too, she saw, I mean, the most important thing is following the truth, right? Trusting in God, he's going to provide. It's very scary, but it was not one of those things where, okay, Catholicism is true, but I can't convert because I need to be doing this. You know, I know I can make money doing this. You know, that was really never a part of the equation. And then in looking back, God has been incredibly faithful. So I became a Catholic in 2012, and then I started working at the high school in 2013. And then on top of that, I started doing some adjunct work at Belmont Abbey in 2016. And then I'm also teaching a homeschool class in theology. And then also I get paid to sing as well. So God has just he's been so faithful. He has provided for us. We're really, really blessed. Any other questions? I left you about 5 minutes. Oh, got a question. All right, go ahead. That's a fantastic question. That reminds me of something. So when I would teach, so I taught adults in church settings as a Protestant. We would do basic apologetic talks. And so I'd start with things like the nature of truth. Okay, what is truth? How do I know it? What are these different theories of truth? How do I respond to it? And then we'd move to arguments for God's existence. And then we'd move from that to Christian apologetics. Okay, what kind of reasons do I have to support the deity of Christ, that he's not just a man, but that he's also God? So we get into things like the case for the resurrection and then the historical reliability of the New Testament. But I noticed that's basically where I would stop, because I was never convinced as an evangelical Protestant of the sorts of arguments that they would put forward to support sacred scripture, being sacred scripture. I never was really convinced. I was always unsatisfied. And it was when I was studying Catholicism that I realized, wow, the Catholics have a fantastic answer to this. It's the authority of the church. In fact, it's through that authority that I even know what scripture is, that I can have an understanding of it, and so on and so forth. So some of the things I taught were things that both Catholics and Protestants could agree with, right? That was definitely a significant part of my experience. When it comes to those things where we disagree, I never really felt bad about it. Maybe one thing that's really helped me is those evangelical roots that I had, those things that I had as a part of my upbringing, really found more fulfillment in the faith. And so that even though I wasn't necessarily always teaching the right thing, you know, I think there is a sense in which God was still working, right? We would say, now, he doesn't really desire this objectively at all, right? He wants unity for the church, right? We're all supposed to be Catholic. But in God's generosity and graciousness, you know, I see how, okay, even though I wasn't really fully there and right on track, you know, it doesn't mean that it was all a waste. And in fact, those things ultimately pointed me to the faith. So I don't know if that, yeah. Yeah. Right. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, and they don't even realize it. Like, I never realized, the Eucharist was not on my radar as an evangelical Protestant. It wasn't until I started investing in Catholicism and then started attending Mass and then became a Catholic. It was like, wow, I had no idea what I was missing out on. Yeah.
Hello, all. My name is Gretchen Fills, parishioner here at St. Thomas Aquinas, and this is my conversion story. I was raised in the Plymouth Brethren, more commonly called the Brethren, the Assembly, or the Meeting. This is a small community of Bible-believing Christians with generally Baptist-like theology radically sola scriptura, who attempt to live and worship according to their understanding of what the early church did. Our claim to theological fame, in fact, was that we invented the dispensationalism heresy. The assembly believed in an informal, Holy Spirit-led worship of God and rejected any kind of ecclesiastical hierarchy or leadership, as well as the concept of Christian denominations altogether. In fact, they don't consider themselves a denomination. We would call ourselves non-denominational because we believed that we were simply the true church living according to the way God intended Christians to live and worship as described in the New Testament. The Plymouth Brethren consider all mainline Protestant denominations as going astray from the true ideal of the church, although they weren't as bad as the Catholic Church, which for them was the epitome of a religion gone astray. So I grew up in Plymouth Brethren, as my parents did before me, and this was all I knew. We were quite exclusive and mostly associated with other families in the assembly. The Plymouth Brethren were very good about learning and teaching scripture. I had to memorize a new Bible verse by heart every week, so that was ingrained in me. Growing up, I was always interested in religion and learning more about my faith. I enjoyed Sunday school, vacation Bible school, Bible studies, youth conferences, Bible camp, mission trips, and the like. In fact, it was actually a nice way to grow up if you were a Protestant. I think that ultimately, the Plymouth Brethren gave me the best preparation I could have had for Catholicism later in my life. The Plymouth Brethren were very serious about religion and worship. Wrong, but serious. Okay, during and after my college years, I became acquainted with, so now that was my background. I'm gonna move into my closer conversion story. So during and after my college years, I became acquainted with Christian apologetics, which is defending the truth of the Christian faith. Things like proofs for the existence of God, evidence for the historicity and divinity of Christ, and the like. This piqued within me a desire to learn and know more about my faith formally. Perhaps I could take some classes, and I thought I could certainly put my education to good use because I had always been so involved in Bible-based activities. By the way, for the old school assembly, the thought of studying theology under other Protestants who were themselves in error is somewhat of an oddity. So I did some research, and I discovered a place called Southern Evangelical Seminary right here in Charlotte, and Christian apologetics was one of their majors. It seemed providential. So I signed up for classes and began working towards a master's degree in Christian apologetics. Southern Evangelical Seminary, as its name suggests, had a Southern Baptist / evangelical theology without being formally associated with any specific group. It was a unique place in that they taught classical theism and metaphysical realism, both largely rooted in the thought of St. Thomas Aquinas. There was no better teacher of apologetics than St. Thomas Aquinas with his masterful Summa Theologica and Summa Contra Gentiles, in which he methodically and skillfully dismantled error with piercing logic. So I was taught by Protestant evangelicals who also claimed to be Thomists, which was intriguing, if not outright contradictory. At SES, I was also introduced to other great thinkers in the church, such as Augustine, Anselm, Albert the Great, and so on. We read the primary source texts, their actual writings, and it was my first time being introduced to these figures. And when you read these men, you discover not only their brilliance, but their palpable holiness that came through their writings, which was not the same with the non-Catholic Christian philosophers we were reading as well. These men were saints, and you could tell. I had never before read anything written by a saint outside of the New Testament, and I was impressed, to say the least. The SES professors taught the philosophy of Aquinas without his theology. Although this wasn't said explicitly, it was as if our professors believed that Aquinas adhered to the theological errors of his time, but today we know better, thanks to the Protestant reformers who set things straight. If Aquinas would have lived during or after the Protestant Reformation, he would have been sola scriptura and sola fide, just like a good evangelical. He would have been one of us. So the professors compartmentalized Aquinas, while many of their students, like me, were intrigued by Thomas Aquinas, the man. How could he be the greatest philosophical genius of all time, which was obviously a God-given gift, and be so off track with his theology? You begin to dig a little, and you come across other things written by Aquinas, like sermons and prayers, which are exquisite and better than anything you personally have ever prayed in your life or even had a thought of God that rose to his level of devotion. And you also discover that his prayers were Eucharistic and Marian. I honestly believe that St. Thomas Aquinas was interceding for the SES students who were reading and studying his writings because so many former students from this school have converted to Catholicism, and all of them on individual paths from different class years, people who never knew each other. So, gradually, my mind opened to the whole church that existed outside of my Plymouth Brethren context. And then I began to realize, me as someone who believed that the Bible is all you need, that the church thrived without a complete canon of scripture for longer than the United States has been a country. How did Christians have the content of the faith if they didn't have a complete canon of scripture? How did they know everything they were to believe? And some of them had no scriptures at all because they were hand-copied and rare. And added to this, you begin to comprehend that the church was united in doctrine and communion, east and west, for 1,000 years until the Great Schism. For 1,000 years, that's a long time. And even then, the Great Schism was mostly about politics. And in the Western Roman Church, for 1,500 years until Martin Luther, John Calvin, and the other Protestant destroyers came on the scene, you had 1,500 years of unity of faith. That's really significant. Are we saying that for 1,500 years, Christians were mistaken about what they believed until the revolutionaries came along and enlightened everyone? Because in fact, they taught a much different theology and a much different understanding of what the church was. And you begin to ask these questions as a student, because the more you dig into the foundation of this Baptist evangelical Protestantism you adhere to, the more it falls apart. And over time, you realize that your strongly held theological beliefs have never been subject to critical thinking or historical accuracy. A few logic and philosophy classes make the inconsistencies in your beliefs come to light. Meanwhile, these medieval Christian philosophers, who were also devout practicing Catholics, had a much richer spiritual life than me, as evidenced by what and how they wrote. They were in the major leagues in faith and intellect, and I was trying out for T-ball. Despite all my years of going to Bible camps and Bible studies, the only option I had for growing closer to the Lord was to read the Bible more and pray harder. But that didn't result in the kind of faith that Aquinas and Anselm prayed with. As an aside, at one point in my early 20s, before I went to SES, I was doing a Bible in a year reading plan, and I was reading in the Old Testament about the Israelites being guided through their desert wanderings by the Lord, who was visible to them as a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And I said to the Lord, "In all things, your church has it better in this age of grace than the Israelites did, except in this one thing. Your real presence was with them in a way that they could tangibly see and point to. We don't have that same real presence as they did." And I felt disappointed by that thought. So at Southern Evangelical Seminary, I studied apologetics and philosophy, and I was introduced to the church in a way I had never been before, as I said. Up until then, I only knew about the church in three segments: the Church of the New Testament, then you fast forward 1,500 years to the Protestant Reformation, and then you fast forward again to the age of Billy Graham, where we live now. SES taught classical theism, and I came to realize that with apologetics, you have to use classical theism to defend the truth of Christianity, which actually means you're going back to the Catholic thinkers who refuted these errors a long time ago. You're always punting to these pre-Reformation Catholics to answer the apologetic debates of the 21st century. So I gradually learned there's another name for classical theism. It's called Catholicism. By the time I was nearing the completion of my degree, I was pretty sure I was going to convert to the Catholic Church. Now I'll talk about some of the key light bulb moments along the way that were stepping stones to my conversion. One of these moments was in one of my first New Testament classes. I learned that the Greek word for saved in the New Testament doesn't always mean eternal salvation. Sometimes in the context, it's talking about temporal salvation, as in salvation from your trials, from your temptations, from your enemies, etc. It's not always talking about eternal salvation from hell. And I was like, are you kidding me? Like that, it doesn't always mean eternal salvation. All these proof texts that I have learned and heard my whole life about being saved, especially to refute Catholicism, and those aren't all references to eternal salvation? Another key moment was reading St. Augustine in class. Again, when you're introduced to these thinkers, their intelligence and sanctity jumps off the page and penetrates into your soul, and you know it's the truth. And more than that, you want what they have, and you see that what they have is so much richer than what you have, and they're living a vibrant Christianity while you're living some kind of broken down imitation of it. I began to notice that I couldn't say I was any holier than as where I was in my life, as I was from years before. And I began to open up to the thought that maybe the Catholic Church, which I had always been taught and believed was not only a false religion, but among the worst evils, had something to teach me about my faith. And I think that was the crack in the door and the light started pouring in. In a passage that we read about St. Augustine, he talked about faith seeking understanding. He said, don't try to understand so that you may believe, but believe so that you may understand. So the act of faith comes first before God gives you the understanding. And I took that to heart, and it put things in the right perspective for me. And St. Augustine, in the same passage, talks about how you have to submit to those who are trying to teach you and learn from them with a certain docility before you can be in a position to evaluate what you're being taught. I then understood that I couldn't try to understand everything the Catholic Church taught before I would decide to believe it. And I took on an interior disposition of docility and submission, recognizing that the Catholic Church has at least some truth to teach me, and I will pursue that truth about God even from this forbidden source. But not that I would accept all of it, because, you know, Catholicism is so clearly wrong about a lot of things and downright strange in many ways. But there are certainly things I can borrow to enrich my own spiritual life. Another key moment was when I was reading on a particular apologetics topics, or a particular apologetics topic. I had two books on the same topic. Don't remember what it was. One of the books was written by a Catholic priest and the other by a few Protestant scholars. And reading through both books on the same topic, I could see how the Catholic author was talking about a topic on a level that vastly outstripped the Protestant scholars. You could tell the Catholic author's grasp of the topic was richer and more complete because he was standing on the shoulders of the giants that came before him, while the Protestant authors were building from square one based on their own lights, which I could tell were dim compared to the Catholic author, who had not only his mind, but the mind of the church that had already thought through that topic for hundreds of years. And the Catholic author was speaking through that tradition while the Protestant authors had only their own opinions. And you realize how futile it is for Protestant scholars to be writing and arguing on these theological topics in these books I was reading that were already decided by the church hundreds of years ago. The debate is over. And those are the list of books that Scott talked about. You know, that debate is over. It was decided hundreds of years ago. I realized that most Protestants, even the scholars, just don't fully grasp what the Catholics are saying, although they think they do, because they're just not on the same level. It's like the game of telephone. The further down the line you get, the original message gets distorted and lost. And Protestantism has been out of the conversation for 500 years, and so they don't truly understand the way Catholics think and speak about theology. A few years in of study, and I began myself to easily recognize objections to Catholicism as straw men, because I was learning the Catholic intellectual tradition. Another key moment is that I'm learning about philosophy and how to make sound arguments. And you learn to recognize your own presuppositions that you're bringing to topics. And then you realize that a lot of your opinions that you're holding don't have a lot to stand on. One day, one of my professors called me out because of how I was speaking about the church. This was a professor who would also later convert to Catholicism. I was assuming that the church was invisible, as in the invisible union of all believers. That is, the church is made up of all those who are saved, saved being defined as those people who at one point in time asked Jesus into their heart to take their sins away. In seminary, I learned that you have these presuppositions, these lenses and assumptions through which you understand things, and you don't realize it until it's challenged. And he pointed out my presupposition and challenged it, asking me to defend my notion that the church is invisible, because that isn't what the New Testament teaches or what the early church believed in practice. Again, this professor was on his way into the Catholic Church himself. They knew who the apostles and their successors were and who had the authority. The church was definitely visible. Everyone knew who was in charge and what it was. And that thought alone, that shift from the church being invisible to something that was visible, was a huge eye-opener to me, was a huge eye-opener for me. And I came to learn that Martin Luther, with his emphasis on the priesthood of all believers, pushed the idea of the church being invisible in order to get adherents to follow his doctrine, because any good Catholic knows that he has to be in communion with his bishop and receive the sacraments in order to be in the church. If you're not baptized, you're not a member of the church or even a Christian. And if you're not in union with the bishop, you're a schismatic. Everyone knew this. It had been understood for 1,500 years. So it would have been hard for Martin Luther to start a new movement, or any of the reformers for that matter, without pushing this idea of an invisible church that you can belong to, even if you're not going to Mass or receiving the sacraments anymore. And then there was the moment that I grasped what the church taught about the real presence of Jesus in the Holy Eucharist. This is not figurative. It is really him there, and I instantly knew that it had to be true. Because I remembered my prayer after reading about the Israelites being guided by the pillar of cloud and fire, and thinking that they back then had it better. We have his real presence in the form of bread and wine, which we consume, and it becomes part of us. And that truly is better than the Israelites had it. In fact, the Old Testament account was a foreshadowing of Christ's real presence in the Catholic Church in the Holy Eucharist. When I learned about transubstantiation, I believed it instantly because of that prayer I had prayed those years before. And then there came a moment when I was pretty serious about the Catholic Church. I understood the necessity of there being an authority who ultimately decides which side of a debate is closer to the truth. And I knew then that I had to come to terms with the Blessed Virgin Mary. I had to tackle her up front. I knew the best way I could tackle the difficulty of Mary, so to speak, was by praying the rosary, which was definitely daunting. I wasn't quite ready for praying it, but I could start with just a Hail Mary. Through searching online, I found a 3 Hail Mary novena prayer, which I thought I could handle. I printed it out and kept it on my bedside table to pray daily. And as I was praying that novena, over time, I could tell that interiorly things were happening and I was growing in virtue. I was able to overcome difficulties that I was struggling with and conquer them. I realized that the sanctification process was tangibly happening in a way that I hadn't experienced before. I could look back and see that I was better than I was before I started praying it. And this gave me the confidence to try to pray the rosary in its entirety. I was still apprehensive about praying the rosary. My images of rosaries were these big, gaudy, rattly things with fat pearl beads and dangly, jeweled crucifixes. These decorative, swingy, stringy things that were overkill for me at the time. They just intimidated me. The rosary intimidated me. So I bought a rosary wrap bracelet because it seemed more understated and casual, which made me more comfortable to physically hold it and pray with it. The first time I prayed the rosary, I thought, oh my goodness, I'm about to tread into idolatry here. I was really apprehensive, scared, nervous. It just felt wrong. And at the same time, I was determined to give it a chance. And I overcame this conflict by thinking or praying, I can't remember which, that I was doing this because I believed I was pursuing truth to grow closer to God in the spirit of faith seeking understanding. And I just made an act of trust that if I was going off the rails, God would bring me out of whatever errors I may be falling into. And so, as I'm praying the rosary for the first time, and it was very uncomfortable doing these repetitious prayers, which you have always been taught that was praying like a pagan. And I asked myself, why did this feel so uncomfortable? And I realized that it felt uncomfortable because it was as if I was giving Mary veneration that is only proper to Jesus. And then right away the thought came to me that no, you're giving Mary the veneration that's proper to her rightful place, which means that you have never been giving our Lord the proper veneration due to him as God. meaning that my thoughts about Jesus didn't exalt him enough. Protestants tend to have a casual, Jesus is my buddy mentality, and they don't really have the level of reverence for Jesus that the Catholics do. That's why they have such a problem with the reverence they see for Mary, because it's more than what they give Jesus. And so I realized in that moment that the rosary was safe for me to pray every day, and it was true that Mary brings people to Jesus, like the Catholic Church said. If you're devoted to her, she will bring you to her son. She's a facilitator of that relationship, not a competitor. By praying the rosary one time, I saw Jesus differently than I had before, more exalted as God and creator. And then I knew in that moment that Mary was the real deal, because I understood more clearly the difference between the creator and the creature. If Mary is venerated, Jesus is adored. And I don't think I had ever done that before, or really understood what divine worship even was. After that, I was sold on Mary and became her devotee. When I began praying the rosary, my path into the Catholic Church was like walking on a bed of roses, like falling in love with the church. I was doing a lot of research to continue to understand Catholic teaching, continuing in my disposition of faith-seeking understanding and not the other way around. Every time I'd have a question or thought of some difficulty about the things the Catholic Church taught, I would do a little research on the topic, and the answer would come to me quickly and easily, and I found resonated with me in a way that I could understand. And that happened again and again. And I believe it was Our Lady guiding me by the hand, because I was praying the rosary all along the way. I didn't have some of the difficulties and long years of struggle with Catholic doctrine that some other Catholic converts have had. Although I did do a voracious amount of research, it was a delightful journey of being flooded with divine light as I began slowly to reject the errors of my past. The same year I graduated SES, which was 2011 with Brian, I began RCIA at this parish. And also the same year I did St. Louis de Montfort's total consecration to Jesus through Mary. So all of that happened in 2011. Graduated in the spring, started RCIA in the fall, and we graduated in 2011, right? So then I started RCIA that fall, so then it was later, that the next year, that I would come into the church. Sorry, I got my years mixed up. The same year, I also did St. Louis de Montfort's total consecration to Jesus through Mary, and the rest is history. That's my story. In a nutshell. And did I make it in under 20 minutes? All right, any questions? I know we're over after 8 o'clock. No? Okay. You want to do all three, or? Oh, you're raising your hand. I thought you were like, shut up. That's true. Something was happening. Like, I mean, it's you know, there's something, there's some spiritual cause for that. Yes?
I just had a question. You made reference to a number of graduates from SES at Mount Vernon. How did you know?
You would hear rumors about it. Like, some of them, like, you know, Brian came, actually, a lot of them came to this parish, to be honest, because it was named for St. Thomas Aquinas. Several of them came through here. Were you in RCIA here? Did you go to RCIA?
I went to RCIA in 2010 and 11, and I wasn't ready at the Easter Vigil.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
That was part of
oh,
it.
Oh, that's right.
So
yeah, yeah, yeah.
I wasn't ready until December 2012.
That's right. I remember yep. that. Yeah, so you would hear about them. So, I mean, there were some who came before us, like Scott, who converted, and then you would hear through the grapevine. But it wasn't like a single movement where we all decided, okay, we're going to start RCIA together. It wasn't like that. Everybody was on an individual path. we all three going to stand up and...
But then there were also two professors that converted, and that was just kind of earth-shaking at the time.
Yes. I mean, you really believe that at one moment you ask Jesus to come in your heart and you're locked in for heaven no matter what you do. It doesn't matter. You can even reject Jesus. It doesn't matter. You're going to heaven. I mean, for generally the most part of Baptist-style evangelical Protestants. I mean, generally.
That was a big part of it.
The thing is you can't pin everything on any one denomination because they all believe something different. But that's probably like the general American version of that belief, I'd say.
And then you even have differences even amongst Baptists. So yeah, you have this prevalent, okay, I made that decision when I was really little. Okay, that person as they got older didn't exactly live for our Lord. Okay, that gives me comfort that they made that decision when they were little. You also then came across, though, a different sort of view, which was if you were to fall away later in your life, this shows you never had saving faith to begin with.
Yeah, if you fall away, it was proof you were never saved.
Right, and so they would sort of backload the gospel with works. Okay, it's by faith alone, but if you're not living for Christ, you don't really have that saving faith. And then another view was just, well, you lose your faith you lose your salvation if you just get to that point where you reject Jesus or you don't live for him. So you have different views, but that was a very...
It was like the...
That was a very significant one. Yeah. And then we had, especially one professor, probably more than one, that held to that sort of view. So...
The main one that I heard was that, yeah, if you fell away, that was proof that you really never had faith to begin with.
Well, it's a joke. It's the St. Thomas Aquinas is the patron saint. What were you saying now? It was very difficult for me. So giving your first confession when you're in your 30s, I was... not exactly enthusiastic about that. I remember I had this email exchange with Father Kauf at the time because he was the last priest. I had various interactions with priests, all sorts of questions. He was the last one in line. And I remember he sent me an email back. He was like, hey, buck up. It's only the forgiveness of your sins. You know, classic Father Kauf style, right? But it was very scary for me. But at the same time, too, when I finished doing it, it was incredible, the sense of peace that I experienced. And I look back on my life and I see, you know, okay, the stress, having a personal relationship with Christ, okay, what does that look like? And I saw different points in my upbringing, me and my friends, like we would want to rededicate our life to Christ, or we would want to have this sort of renewal or revival. And looking back, what we were really longing for, at least to some extent, was the sacrament of confession.
And I know for me, when I was in RCIA, I did my first confession in January, so kind of early in it. And I was looking forward to it. It wasn't scary. I had 30 years of stuff to confess, so it wasn't pleasant, but it was what it is. But when the priest, when Father Winslow, absolved me of my sins, it was kind of like the final part of that evangelical paradigm just kind of fell away for me. And it was almost like, so when that happened, I wasn't Catholic yet, but I had crossed the threshold. And when I was in RCIA, you reach a point where, I told Gretchen, if I don't become Catholic, I don't know what I'm going to be because I can't go back to what I was.
Yeah, you can't go
that.
Back. Yeah.
I'll be a dude worshiping God in my kitchen by myself Sunday mornings if I don't become Catholic.
No, that's very true.
Describe what it was like, your first mass that you attended. Was it weird? Was it great? What was
I don't know if I should answer that question.
I'll go first. You don't know. My first Mass, so I was ordained a Baptist minister in 2009. First Mass was fall of 2010, and I was already heavy into the studies, right? Getting exposed to Catholic apologetics, heavy into that. And I was already, I think, becoming convinced of the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, for example, and the unique things that were happening in the Mass. And so I finally got to the point to where my family and I went to Mass for the first time in Lancaster, South Carolina, at St. Catherine. And so we were friends with the Patrizzos. I don't know if you've heard of the organization Project to Heal, but they still live in the Charlotte area, and they were attending that parish that was pretty close to their house, still is to this day. So for the first time, my family and I went to Mass, and it's this really small parish in Lancaster, South Carolina. The music was terrible. It was really bad. But when the Eucharistic liturgy happened, the priest was incredibly reverent. And there was a spiritual experience there for me for the first time. It's like, okay, something is going on here. And so it's a really special moment for me, is going to Mass for the first time, even though the music wasn't very good, being exposed to the Eucharistic liturgy, and then seeing the reverence, not just among the priests, but the reverence among the people. Like, yeah, they really believe this is Jesus. You know, this isn't social hour. I mean, this is, we are worshiping God himself. He's becoming present. It was incredibly special.
Actually, I do know how to answer the question. Okay. I'll just keep it anonymous, but I won't say what parish I was at.
Okay.
That's what I was at. So I was, I had gone to, with two other SES students and their spouses, and we went to one of these churches to the Saturday night vigil Mass, my first time stepping into the Catholic Church. I think a couple of other ones had been before, and we were exploring, you know, Catholicism and putting our foot in the water. And all of us had gotten to the point where we completely rejected evangelical everything. Like, we were already there. And so we went to this church, this Catholic church, and then we realized that it was very evangelical. And we immediately knew that, like, we could, it's like our radar, you know, because we're already convinced we want to go back to the tradition. We want to, you know, we already know we want to just forget all of this modern stuff and go back to, you know, real Catholicism, medieval Catholicism. We all, like, loved the medieval Catholicism because that's what we were studying in school. That's where the real faith was that we were exposed to. And so, yeah, we went to this parish, and it was very evangelical, and it just didn't, it felt like you could feel it, your radar was up. And so we all talked about it. We went to dinner, and I'm like, oh my goodness, that was so Protestant, you know? And then none of us, like, we all went in different paths, but I was like, not that. No, thank you. Give me something that is more traditional. And then I found my way to this parish, which was beautiful, under Father Winslow, Father Kauth, and Father Christian, who came here, and then it felt right, like it was more true to what Catholicism is.
And if I'm thinking of the right person, which I think I probably am, for him, it became a stumbling block. Like, going to a Catholic parish that looked very evangelical to him. You know, he was really looking for something else, right? So for him, it was a stumbling block. And I mentioned in my talk, too, the sacred music. Like, that beauty, that polyphony, the motets, the chant, being exposed to that while you're going to Mass and you're searching out, is Catholicism true? That's really helping to bring life, along with the other beauty, right? Really helping to bring to life those supernatural mysteries that are really happening. So I think that the beauty that we find in the sacred music and in the traditions really helps to convert somebody.
And I know for me, I had been at, you know, two Masses with my sister and one of my sisters-in-law, you know, years, like, when becoming Catholic wasn't even on my radar, so I was already familiar with it. You know, I didn't get it. I didn't get the up and down and all this kind of stuff. I didn't like going, though, because I couldn't receive the Eucharist, and I understood the reasons why I couldn't go, and so, you know, at some point, I just, like, I would go with my sister-in-law and her family, and my, like, two of my brothers have married Catholic women, so it's kind of interesting. My family, I had three older brothers. Two of them have married Catholic women.
And so all of their kids, you know, have been raised Catholic. So I have 7 nieces and nephews. 6 of them are already Catholic. The one who's not Catholic actually went to Catholic University for college. But anyway, but when I came here and started coming to Mass, it took a good 6 months before I really could get into it and enter into the worship, because it's really like, it is like learning a new language. And the reverence is what really captures you. You know, especially before a church service in the evangelical Protestant world, the noisier it is, the better. You know, you're just talking with your buddies, and it's almost like God isn't even in the building. And so the lack of reverence in the evangelical Protestant world is really what captured me when I started coming to Mass here.
Do you have a question?
What was that again? When did we start doing it?
When did we start doing it?
I talked about
Gretchen
that.
Shared about that.
Yeah, it was, speaking of the rosary, so Fred Beretta, he was that Catholic that I came across when I was teaching piano lessons during my second master's degree. He ended up giving me a whole stack of books, and one of them was True Devotion. And he told me, he was like, and of course this is all about the Blessed Mother, really, really deep dive there. He said, don't read that until after you've become Catholic. I said, okay. So, of course, my wife and I, we have all sorts of theological conversations. I mentioned this to her, and guess what she does? Oh, I'm going to dive right on in. And before you know it, she was praying the rosary. She was attending daily Mass. This is before we came into full communion with the church. And so for her, she was really drawn to the Blessed Mother. I think that was really, the Blessed Mother really aided her in her conversion. For me personally, I didn't start doing that until later. I think one of the things that helped me is from an apologetic, logical sort of standpoint, once you accept the authority of the church, right, once you have been convinced of that truth, that Jesus established the Catholic Church and the magisterial authority, the teaching authority of the church, and that he's guiding the church's teachings ultimately. Once you establish that point, I think Scott mentioned this, like everything else is going to follow from that. Okay, well, here's what the church teaches about the Blessed Mother. I came to believe those teachings based upon the authority of the church. Now, of course, I looked into it and I thought, hey, that makes sense, right? When you look at the typology in the Old Testament and how that points forward to the Blessed Mother, for example. When you think about the rosary, I mean, the first part of the Hail Mary, that's sacred scripture, right? Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. So for me, it was a little, you know, uncomfortable, I think, when I first started doing it. But I think it was one of those just steps of faith. And the Blessed Mother has been amazing. So
I prayed it for the first time, you know, while I was in RCIA. It just was, like, I tell the current RCIA people, I think part of the RCI process is start acting Catholic before you even become Catholic. And so that was part of it for me. It was just kind of the next thing you did in the whole process of becoming Catholic was to pray the rosary. And so I prayed it a few times while I was in RCIA, and then it's become a regular thing, you know, since I became Catholic. I will point out one thing about Mary, the evangelical view of Mary, it's like a counter overcorrection with Mary, you know, and I've told people here before, you know, we would do Sunday school classes on the great women of the faith in the evangelical world that I came from, and the women that were discussed would be, you know, Ruth and Esther and Mary Magdalene, and Mary wouldn't even be one of the women who were the great women of the faith. And so it just seemed, in hindsight, it's just bizarre that at a minimum you got to give her due. You know, she's an important figure in the faith, whether you believe what Catholics believe about her, but the evangelical world has just like overcorrected that view. It's really interesting.
That's interesting. You learn little tidbits, like I think Martin Luther had a devotion to the Blessed Mary, to the Blessed Mother, I think, if I'm not mistaken. It's like, wow, okay. Protestantism is not monolithic at all. It's very diverse.
We don't talk about it. Yeah, I mean, they think I'm crazy. So, no, we don't talk about it. They don't, it's just, you just don't talk about it. So yeah. That's the way it is in my family. My parents were upset that I converted. They were really torn up about that. And my siblings, I don't think any of them liked it. I think that they all think, you know, they think what, you know, how evil the Catholic Church is. That's the way we were raised, and I think that's what they think. And the fact that I'm Catholic, and it's just, we just avoid the topic because I think it's too sensitive.
I enjoy those sorts of conversations. sometimes, you know, like I mentioned, my dad and I, we would have all sorts of theological conversations when I was going through seminary. Still, sometimes to this day, you know, he'll ask me questions, and I just, I don't take any personal offense. You know, whenever he tries to dig some dirt on the church, or he mentions some sort of current event that provides some sort of difficulty, and I don't see it as a threat at all, right? I mean, if you've really studied and really just looked deep into these things, it's the Catholic faith really is the fullness of the faith. We really do have great answers to these questions, and so for me, it's kind of a fun thing, but just be basically try to be very civil, agree to disagree, right? And respect each other in the midst of our disagreements. So,
for me, it's not an issue. Like I told you, you know, my sister's Catholic. Two of my brothers have married Catholic women. Of my three brothers, one of them is a believer. He and his wife are Methodist. My other two brothers aren't even believers. So it's like there was no resistance, you know. And my dad, He didn't really care that, you know, that I was going to, I didn't have the same reaction from my dad that, you know, Gretchen had from her parents. So fortunately, it's not an issue, you know, and what my prayer has really been for my next generation, my nieces and nephews who have various level, who are already Catholic, have various levels of faith, that they'll see something in me that they'll come to appreciate their faith more because they see what, you know, what's happened with me.
A really funny story. Just my dad and I recently talked. The topic of priestly celibacy came up. And of course, he was of the mindset of, okay, this is an unrealistic expectation that you guys put upon your priests. And so we were having this conversation, and I just politely said, well, what about what St. Paul says about the benefits of celibacy? 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And he said something like, oh, well, I don't think Paul was right. And and I thought, wait a minute, I don't think he really fully realized what he just said. But so we'll have, you know, it was a very cordial conversation.
But that's the evangelical paradigm. I am the arbiter of truth.
Oh, definitely there's been difficulties. You know, there's been certain parts of it where certain parts have been totally foreign, right? Now, not so much now because I've been a Catholic for 10 years, but, you know, when I was first transitioning, there was, you know, some things that I had to get used to. You know, such as, for example, the veneration of the cross on Good Friday. Okay, are we worshiping the cross? What's going on here, right? Even though I could intellectually give a response to that, still though emotionally and personally, Okay, everybody's kneeling as the cross is, you know, coming by us. Are we worshiping? What's going on here? Definitely things involving the current day situation and the hierarchy has presented certain difficulties. For example, I'm a fan of the Latin Mass. I mean, I think you can have a beautiful Novus Ordo Mass and a beautiful Latin Mass, and I just don't really quite understand why there's this hostility towards the Latin Mass, right? Don't really understand that. Sometimes when we get in our theological conversations, my dad will bring up some, you know, well, what about Nancy Pelosi as a Catholic, right? She's allowed to receive communion. What about Joe Biden, right? Or, you know, other people, whatever. Or he'll bring up some sort of corruption that's happening. So, yeah, definitely been presented with difficulties, but, you know, there's good answers. So when I became a Catholic, I knew there was already corruption in the church to a certain extent. When you look at the history of the church, the church is full of that. I remember Dr. Peter Kraft, if you know who that is. At one point when he was thinking about becoming a Catholic, his friends wanted him to read a book. It was all about the corruption and the ineptitude of the church. And for him personally, he said, it almost made me Catholic on the spot. The fact that you had such ineptitude and such corruption, oh, this is not just merely a human institution. This thing would have crumbled a long time ago. So, definitely difficulties, but I don't regret it for a single second, becoming a Catholic. It is, like I said, it's been more of the fulfillment of my desires that I had growing up, amongst other things.
I had no problems with it, because I think the Plymouth Brethren, there was a split in the Plymouth Brethren, and then you realize that even